हाय एवरीवन, नमस्ते। सो वी कंप्लीटेड सरफेस केमिस्ट्री बिकॉज ऑफ टाइम वेरी लेस, सो आई एम कंप्लीटिंग फास्टली। सो नाउ वी विल स्टडी मेटलर्जी चैप्टर। सो मेटलर्जी एक्चुअली इन द एनसीईआरटी टेक्स्ट बुक द चैप्टर नेम इज द प्रिंसिपल्स एंड प्रोसेस ऑफ एक्सट्रैक्शन ऑफ एलिमेंट्स। सिंपली इन शॉर्टकट वी कैन कॉल इट इज अ मेटलर्जी। Now, what is studying metallurgy? Metallurgy is a process of extraction of elements from their available compounds. Because most of the periodic table elements are there, except some noble gases and noble metals. Remaining all elements always exist in the compoundary state. For example, we are taking sodium. The sodium will exist in the form of its oxide or halide form. Similar like iron. Iron will be exist in the form of oxide like hematite, magnetite. So most of the elements, due to their high reactivity, they always exist in compoundary state. So from this compoundary state, when we are extracting metal, then that process is called metallurgy. So it is a very very simple chapter. So all definitions and examples we have to remember. That is the chapter. Only examples and definitions most important. So metallurgy is a study of extraction of elements from their available compounds. Now, what are their available compounds? The available compounds can be oxides or halides or carbonates or whatever, sulfides, sulfates, like that. So most of the elements exist in the form of compounds. So compounds can be oxides, halides, carbonates, sulfides. Sulfates are there. So there are some important available compounds are there. So I'll give one table so that you have to remember their formulas. Sometimes four formula also they will ask. So that's why formulas we have to remember. I'll give one table. Just practice that table. Important formulas I'm giving. Just practice that. So it is very important. So these are the some important compounds of metal. Aluminium, iron, copper, zinc are given. So aluminium is available in the form of bauxite, carbonite. Iron is in the form of hematite, magnetite, siderite, iron pyrites, like that, copper, copper pyrites, melanocyte, zinc, zinc blend, calumet, like that. So formulas also are given. Just write these formulas and practice this. So from this, sometimes formula also they will ask. So that's why remember these formulas. So mostly these are important. So practice this. So now we will go to the chapter. So from these available compounds, the extraction of elements, metals, is called metallurgy. So metallurgy involves number of techniques. First, some definitions we will say. The first definition is mineral. So mineral is nothing but it is the compound of metal which is extracted from earth crust. So from the earth crust or from the mines, when we are excavating these compounds, so these are called minerals. Simply mineral is a compound is coming from the earth crust which contains some percent of metal. If any compound contains some percentage of metal, that is called mineral. If metal is not there, so we cannot call it as a mineral. So any compound from the mines or from the earth crust contains some percent of metal, then that is called mineral. Another one is the ore. So what is ore? Is ore is also mineral, but from which mineral metal we can extract profitably? So metal, when we are extracting profitably, economically, then that mineral is called ore. That means ore is also mineral, because some minerals may not give metal profitably, but from some minerals we get metal profitably by economical condition. So such minerals are called ores. So ore definition. So it is a mineral from which metal we can get economically profitable. So another definition like mineral ore, some extra particles also there. GaN. So GaN is nothing but it is the infusible impurity present in the ore. So ore means what is a mineral? Which contains some metal also, which contains some impurities also. If the impurities are infusible, then we cannot remove them. then such impurities are called gang. So gang is an infusible impurity. So to remove this gang, we add some additional material. So those additional materials are called flux. So flux is an additional material which is added to remove gang. So another is the slag. When gang is combining with flux, the product is called slag. The slag can be easily removed. So preparation, just remember examples I'll give later. So mineral is a compound of metal which is extracted from the earth crust. From which mineral metal can be extracted profitably? And that mineral is called ore. If the infusible impurities are present, then the infusible impurities are called gangs. That gangs can be removed by adding additional material. Those are called flux. Similarly, flux and gang converted to fusible product, that is called slag. So these are some important definitions. So metallurgy is the extraction of metals from the ore. Now metallurgy involves number of techniques. The first technique is purification of ore. That is the first technique, purification of ore. The second technique is after purification. So we have to do some techniques. That is the reduction of ore to metal. After that, purification of metal. There are mainly three techniques involved in the metallurgy. In the first step, we have to purify the ore, whatever the ore you are getting from the earth crust or from mines. First, that we have to purify. After purification, that ore we are reducing to metal. Ore is converted to metal. That is called reduction. After getting metal, that metal is also purified. The last step is the purification of metal. These three techniques we completed. That is the complete chapter of metallurgy. First is purification of ore. So ore can be purified by number of techniques. So this purification of ore, also called concentration, which is also called beneficiation, which is also called dressing. So concentration, dressing, beneficiation or purification of ore, all are same meaning. Concentration, beneficiation, dressing, which is called nothing but purification of ore. So to purify the ore, there are mainly four techniques we use. The first technique is called hydraulic washing. The second technique is called froth flotation. The third technique is called magnetic separation. And the fourth technique is called leaching. So these are mainly four important techniques to purify a ore. A ore can be purified by four techniques: hydraulic washing, froth flotation, magnetic separation, leaching. Now among these four techniques, first three techniques are called physical process by physical method, and the fourth one is by chemical method. Remember it, leaching is a chemical method, so remaining three are physical method. So one by one we'll say. The first one is hydraulic washing. So what is hydraulic washing is, in this process we can remove low density impurities like clay, sand, like this. When compared with pure metal, impurities present as low density, so they can be removed by hydraulic washing. So what is actually hydraulic washing is, in this process we use a vibratory belt. So this is a belt. So this belt is a vibratory belt. So on this vibratory belt we are taking a ore, but that ore must be in powdered form. So first ore we are crushing into powder, and that crushed ore we are taking on this belt. So this belt is a vibratory belt. So on vibrating, So this ore containing some pure particle also, impure particle also. But impure particles density is very less. So when it is vibrating, so low density impurities are highly vibrated like this. Whereas high density particles will be vibrate only very small height. So low density are very highly vibrated, whereas high densities are very low vibrated. So this low density impurities can be removed by passing a stream of water. Simply by passing water, we can remove these low density impurities. And this process is called hydraulic washing. So hydraulic washing is also called gravity separation. So why? Because the density separation is there here. Some are low density, some are high density. That's why it is also called gravity separation or density separation. So that is first one is hydraulic washing. So this technique is applicable to removal of low density impurity particles. Similarly, the second one is throat rotation. So in froth rotation technique, this technique is mainly applicable to purification of sulfide ores. Sulfide ores are purified by using this froth rotation technique. What is this froth rotation technique is? In this simplest it is, we are taking a beaker. So in this beaker we are adding water. Let's take beaker like this. So we are adding water and also we are using a paddle here. So this is a circulatory paddle. Now in this water we are adding ore. Whatever the ore we have to purify, that ore we are adding. On adding ore, so whatever the impurities are there, impurities are soluble in water. And remaining ore, whatever is there, that we have to get outside. So to get outside, in this we are adding some particles. So those particles are called frothing agents. So frothing agents can be fine oil, also collectors. Collectors can be xanthates. Also some stabilizers, like aniline, cresol, etc. So also we use some depressants like NaCN. Also we use some activators like copper sulfate. So all these are the metals we are adding. What is the use of these materials is, so frothing agents. So what are the frothing agents is, when we are adding to the this solution, they will form foam. So foam or froth both are same. So they converted to foam, those are called foaming agents, those are called pine oil. At the same time, collectors are there. So what the collectors will do? So collectors will decrease as the wetting capacity of a ore. So ore, when you are dissolving in water, it is wetted by water. So whose wetting capacity can be decreased by adding some additional materials? So those are called collectors. So by adding collectors, so ore is not steeped with water. So those are collectors, which decreases the wetting capacity of whatever the ore. Also some stabilizers are there, like aniline and cresol. So these stabilizers, so will attach the ore particles to the foam. So first foam we are adding, we will form foam. So foam means not directly foam we are adding, some foaming agents like pine oil when we are adding. So they will make foam. To that foam, so these stabilizers will add the ore particles. So ore will be added on the surface of the foam. So foam is a small bubbles like this. So on this surface of these bubbles, ore particles will be steeped like this. So this is called adsorption. So adsorption process, froth rotation is adsorption process. So in the surface chemistry I explained, adsorption one of the uses, froth rotation. So when foam is forming, so on that foam bubbles, ore particles will be stick by the use of stabilizers. And so when our foam is forming, so this is paddle circulating, so impurities are dissolved in the water. So So remaining pure water particles will converted to foam. So foam will be float like this. So foam always float. So this floating foam can be taken outside on drying. So it is forms a pure water particle. So that is called froth flotation. So very simple technique. First powdered ore we are dissolving in water. Impurities are soluble in water. So to get the ore outside, we are adding some additional material. Frothing agents will form foam. Collectors decreases wetting capacity of ore, and stabilizers will add the ore particles to the foam. So formation of ore foam will be there. So this ore foam on drying will get ore particle. So what are these depressant and activators? See this. If the ore whatever you are adding have mixed ore like this zinc sulfide and lead sulfide, two sulfide ores are there. From these two sulfide ores, if you want only one sulfide, another way is not required, then what we will do is we add some depressant. So NaCN depressant on adding to this mixture, the sodium and zinc will combine together and separation of lead sulfide will be possible. So we get lead sulfide ore in the foam. Zinc is directly combines with sodium. This is a depressant which decreases, which removes the, which separate the two sulfide ore particles. So depressants are using to separate sulfide ore particles. Another one is activator. Now whatever the zinc sulfide is present in the solution, it is again activated by using copper sulfate. So first depressant will decreases the reactivity of zinc sulfide and will form the form of lead sulfide. Further zinc sulfide we want, we can activate it by using copper sulfate. So all these are important materials we have to remember. So what are the closing agents, collectors, stabilizers, depressant, activators? Only these will they last. So these are the important materials. So that is the froth flotation process. So the next one is the magnetic separation. So in magnetic separation, so with the help of magnetic field, so we can separate magnetic and non-magnetic particles. So for example, here also we are taking a belt. So this is a circulatory belt. So this belt is circulating on magnetic wheels. So these wheels are magnetic in nature. So on this belt, when we are taking powdered ore, this powdered ore continuously circulate around the belt, and among this ore, some particles are magnetic in nature and some particles are non-magnetic. So non-magnetic particles are repelled by magnetic field, whereas magnetic particles are attracted by magnetic field. So those magnetic and non-magnetic particles we can separate with the help of magnetic separation. So just by using magnetic wheels, so magnetic particles are attracted by magnetic field, they will transfer to one beaker, and so non-magnetic particles, so those are repelled by magnetic field, so those are separated, so those are transferred into another beaker. So this separation is called magnetic separation. So this is mostly useful for hematite, magnetite, whereas iron ores are there. So iron ores are magnetic in nature, whereas impurities like clay sands, those are non-magnetic. So separation of hematite, magnetite, iron pyrites, so can be separated by the help of magnetic separation. So the fourth one, the chemical technique is leaching. So leaching is the dissolving ore in a suitable solvent. So in this process, so which ore we have to purify, that ore we always dissolve in a suitable solvent. So for example, we are taking bauxite. So bauxite is dissolved in NaOH, whereas noble metals dissolve in cyanide solvent, Cn minus, so either NaCn or KCn, whatever. So bauxite, aluminium ore, which is dissolved in NaOH, whereas noble metals like silver, gold, platinum will be dissolved in Cn minus. So these are two important examples. So leaching is the process of dissolution of ore in a suitable solvent. On dissolving bauxite in NaOH, pure bauxite completely dissolved, converted to solution. Whereas impurities are insoluble, they can be filtered out, so we get pure solution. Further, that solution is again converted to our metridine with some reducing agents. Some reactions are explained. So, see the equations in bleaching process. So, mostly two ores are important. One is the bauxite ore. Another one is the noble metal. Here, metal is a noble metal. It can be silver, gold, etc. So, whenever noble metals we are dissolving in cyanide solvent, whereas bauxite we are dissolving in NaOH solvents. Maximum they will ask which is a suitable solvent or so which are reducing agent. See this first, bauxite on dissolving NaOH solution, it is converted to sodium aluminate, NaOH4+. So, this is a solution, impurities are in solid form, they will be filtered. Now, further this solution is passing through carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide passing through the solution, again solid bauxite will be formed. On heating, water molecules will be lost, we get bauxite. So here carbon dioxide is acting as reducing agent, reduces sodium aluminate solutions into bauxite. Similarly, noble metals dissolve in cyanide solvent. On combining with cyanide, will forms so metal cyanide compounds. So which metal cyanides on treated with again zinc? Zinc reduces again metal, formation of noble metal will be takes place. Zinc is the reducing agent. So bleaching is a chemical technique. So with the help of some chemical reactions, we can purify ores. That is the bleaching. So first three are physical techniques. Bleaching is a chemical technique. So total four techniques for the purification of ore. Hydraulic washing, so based on gravity separation. Second is froth flotation, applicable to sulfide ores. So by using some frothing agents and collectors, so we can purify ore. Similarly, third one is the magnetic separation, applicable to separation of magnetic and non-magnetic particles. So leaching is dissolving technique in a suitable solvent. Bauxite solvent is NaOH, noble metal solvents are cyanide solvent. So these are the purification technique. So after the purification, the second technique is reduction of ore to metal. The second technique is reduction of ore to metal. So we know that reduction means removal of oxygen. But remember, so most of the ores will be exist in the form of oxides, halides, sulfides, number of types are there. But reduction of oxygen, the removal of oxygen, very easy when compared with removal of other like sulfur or any other. So that's why before going for reduction of ore to metal, first we have to convert most of the ores into oxide form, because when ore is in oxide form, its reduction is very easy. So that's why mostly all ores we are converting into oxide form by using two techniques. One is called roasting, another one is called calcination. So with the help of these two techniques, ores can be converted to oxide form. Why we are converting into oxide form means because reduction of oxide is easier when compared with other. So roasting is a heating ore. In presence of air. Whereas calcination is heating ore in absence of air. In presence of air, when they are heating ore, that is called roasting. In absence of air heating, that is called calcination. For example, we are taking calcium carbonate. So it is a carbonate ore. So which on heating without air, so we get calcium oxide and carbon dioxide. So carbon dioxide gas will be evaporate. So we get oxide ore. So this is oxide ore. Carbonate ore converted to oxide ore. Same like heating is the heating in presence of air is called roasting. For example, iron sulfide ore on heating in presence of air, so we get oxide ore and sulfur dioxide gas will be evaporate. So we get oxide ore. So sulfide ore we are converted to oxide. Carbonate ore we are converted to oxide. So ores can be converted to oxide either by heating with air or heating without air. So this is called roasting and calcination. So this will be done before the reduction. So why? Because reduction of oxides are very easier and compare with reduction of sulfide or other. So oxide we are converted to oxide form. After that we reduce the O2 metal. So the second technique is reduction of O2 metal. So there are number of techniques to reduce O2 metal. So O can be reduced to metal by using number of techniques. The first one is called smelting. So smelting is the process of reduction of ore with carbon or carbon monoxide. If carbon is a reducing agent or carbon monoxide is a reducing agent, then the process is called smelting. So smelting mostly applicable to less reactive metals like D block and some P block are reduced by carbon and carbon monoxide. So less reactive metals like D block and some P block. So mostly D block elements are less reactive, so they can be reduced by using carbon or carbon monoxide, and that process is called smelting. For example, we are taking Fe2O3. So on reducing with carbon, so carbon removes oxygen, we get CO2, so 3 carbon, so we get iron. Same like PbO, treated with carbon, so we get CO2 plus 2 Pb. So metals here produced from the oxides by reducing with carbon, when mostly applicable to less reactive like B block and some P block elements. So that process is called smelting. Smelting is reduction with carbon or carbon monoxide. Similarly, another reduction is aluminothermic process. In this process, aluminum is reducing agent. So with the help of aluminium, we can reduce number of oxides. The process is called aluminothermic process. But this process mostly applicable to iron oxide, Fe2O3, chromium oxide, boron oxide, and Mn2O3, like this. So mostly these oxides are reduced by aluminium. That process is called aluminothermic process. For example, Fe2O3 treated with aluminium. So we get Al2O3 plus iron metal. So the mixture of aluminium metal and oxide of any of this compound is called thermite mixture. Many of these oxides are mixing with aluminium powder, and that mixture is called thermite mixture. So thermite mixture on fusion, so we get metal. So this process is called aluminothermic process, mostly applicable to iron, chromium, boron and manganese. So these are the important examples of aluminothermic process. The same like another important reduction is electrolytic reduction. So electrolytic reduction is by doing electrolysis, and this electrolytic reduction is mainly applicable to most reactive metal. So most reactive metals like S block and some P block. Smelting is applicable to less reactive, whereas electrolytic reduction is applicable to most reactive. S blocks are most reactive, D blocks are less reactive. P block molecule, some elements are less reactive also there, some elements highly reactive is also there. So highly reactive P block is reduced by electrolytic reduction. Less reactive P blocks are reduced by smelting process. Now this is applicable to S block and whatever there is some P block. For example, S block we are taking, we want sodium. Sodium mostly exists in the form of NaCl. So this NaCl must be present in solid form, but this we must convert it to liquid form. Why? Because electrolysis is applicable to either molten salts or aqueous solutions, not for solids. So first we are melting the salt and doing electrolysis. we get sodium metal at cathode and chlorine gas will be liberated at cathode. So this is electrolysis process. So how to produce products? Electrolysis, electrochemistry products are there. So you can use that. So NaCl on electrolysis, we get sodium solid at cathode, chlorine gas at anode. Similarly, we are taking P block like Al2O3, bauxite. It should be in molten form. On doing electrolysis, so we get Al, 2Al at cathode and 3/2 O2 gas at anode. So this is some P block and mostly S block on our highly reactive. Now in electrolytic reduction, most important part is whatever the salts we are taking, it should be in molten form. But salts are always in solid form. Their melting is very very high, that means high melting point. So to convert it to liquid, so we maintain very high temperature. At this high temperature, so reaction electrolysis will be explosive. So that is a highly costly process. So that's why to decrease this melting point, we add some additional material. So by adding some additional material at low temperature also, they can be converted to liquid. So additional material for NaCl, for example, we add KF plus CaCl2. So these are the additional material for NaCl to decrease their melting point and to increase their conductivity. Same like in Al2O3, we add Na3AlF6. So it is called, so Na3AlF6 called cryolite. So by adding cryolite, the melting point of bauxite can be decreased and conductivity can be increased. So whenever you are doing electrolytic reduction, some additional materials must be added to decrease the melting point and to increase the conductivity. For bauxite, Na3AlF6 we add, that is called cryolite, to decrease melting and increase conductivity. So all these are reduction process, electrolytic reduction and smelting, so also aluminothermic process. So also some auto reduction is also there. So some metals also reduced by self reduction. Self reduction mostly applicable to copper, lead and mercury, etc. So these are the important metals which undergo self reduction. So what is the self reduction means? If any oxide is reduced by its own sulfide, for example, we are taking Cu2S plus 2Cu2O. Here oxide ores are reduced by their sulfide ores. Copper sulfide can reduce copper oxide into copper metal plus sulfur dioxide. So this reaction is called self reduction. Mostly copper, lead, mercury undergo self reduction. So sulfides can reduce their own oxides. The process is called self reduction. So mostly, so these four techniques are important: smelting, self reduction, aluminothermic process, and electrolytic reduction. So after the reduction, the final step is purification of metal. So purification of metal, which is also called refining. So first step is purification of ore. Ore we have to purify. After that, ore we are converting into metal. Finally, whatever the metal we are getting, that is also must be purified. The process of purification of metal is called refining. So in this refining, number of techniques are there. The first one is liquation, like that, distillation. Another is cupellation. Another is Jones refining. Next, like Jones refining. Another is the vapor phase refining. In this vapor phase, Mohns is also there and Van Arkel. when alkali is also there. Another process is the electrolytic refining, simply electrolysis. So all these are the so number of refining techniques. So liquation, distillation, cupellation, and Jones refining, vapor phase refining, electrolysis. So what is the liquation is? Liquation is the purification technique of low melting point metals. Those metals which have low melting point, so that can be purified by the help of liquation. It is nothing but so just whatever the metal we have to purify on heating. So pure metal has low melting point, directly converted to liquid. Impurities are present in solid form, so both can be filtered. That process is called liquation. It is the process of purification of low melting point metals. So liquation is applicable to purification of low melting point metals. Melting point low metals like lead, tin, bismuth, etc. So any metal which has low melting point, so that is purified by liquation technique. Similarly, second one is the distillation. So distillation technique is applicable to purification of low boiling point metals whose boiling point is low, and that metal can be purified by using distillations like zinc, mercury, etc. So cupellation. So one is for low melting point and this is for low boiling point. Cupellation. So what is the cupellation is? That is the process of removal of noble metal impurities. If any metal has some impurities of noble metal, and that removal is called cupellation. The best example, if you are purifying copper metal. So in copper metal, gold doesn't have some impurities. So this impurity of gold can be removed from copper. And that process is called cupellation. So mostly it is applicable to alloys. So in alloys, number of metals are there. So one metal can be removed from other metal. The process is called cupellation. So same like Jones refining is there. Jones refining is the best technique among all for the purification of metal. That's why this is mostly useful for purification of semiconductors. Semiconductors are highly purified by using Jones refining. Semiconductors can be silicon and germanium. So Jones refining applicable to purification of semiconductors. So through this Jones refining, when we are purifying metals, these are highly pure. That's why the metals which are purified by Jones refining are called ultra pure metals. The metals which are purified by Jones refining are called ultra pure metals. So next one is the vapor phase refining. So in this vapor phase refining, by adding some additional material and converted to vapor form, the metals can be purified. That is called vapor phase refining. In vapor phase refining, two processes are there. One is the Mohn's process, another one is the Van Alkyl. So Mohn's process is applicable to nickel, whereas Van Alkyl is applicable to titanium, zirconium, hafnium, etc. Mohn's mainly applicable to nickel, Van Alkyl for titanium, zirconium, hafnium, like that. So both are under vapor phase refining. So what is vapor phase refining means? Suppose you have to purify nickel. First, it is treated with carbon monoxide. On heating, it will form nickel tetracarbolyl. So this will be vapor form, and which on heating at high temperature, again we get pure nickel and carbon monoxide will be liberated. So simply by adding additional material converted to stable complex, we can purify. That purification is called vapor phase refining. If you are purifying nickel, that is called Mohn's process. If you are purifying titanium, zirconium, hafnium, and that is called Van Alkyl process. So in Van Alkyl process, suppose example I am giving titanium, first treated with iodine, converted to TiO4 complex. So which on further heating, again we get pure titanium metal and I2 will be liberated. So in Van Alkyl we add additional material iodine. In Mohn's process, we additional material will be carbon monoxide. So by adding additional material converted to stable vapor form, we can purify. The process is called vapor phase refining. So finally, electrolysis is also there. So electrolysis, as I told, applicable to highly reactive metals. So in this electrolysis, we can purify nickel, chromium, etc. So number of elements are there. So in electrolysis, nickel, chromium, copper, so number of we can purify. For example, I am telling. What we will do in electrolysis? Suppose we are taking copper metal. So this is a copper. So this copper is a impure copper. And this we are taking as a pure copper metal. Both of these are attached to metallic wire and also attached to battery. Also we are using solid bits. So see this. The solution is copper sulfate. Here also copper sulfate. So on applying external electric field, electrons transferred from anode to cathode. Impure metal is acting as anode, pure metal is acting as cathode. So from one metal to another metal, electrons are transferring. On transferring electron, so this impure metal will be dissolved in the solution, and electrons will transfer to the solution. From the solutions, pure metal will be deposited. So this metal gets extra copper. This must be pure copper, and this metal is completely dissolved in the solution. So impure metal is converted to pure metal. This process is called electrolysis. On applying electrolysis, anode always dissolve, cathode always deposit. So impure is dissolving, pure metal is depositing. So we get pure copper. So this process is called whatever the electrolysis process. So all these are purification technique of metals. So all we completed purification of ore, after the reduction of ore to metal, finally purification of metal. So all we completed. So among this, some important definitions are there. Some definitions we'll see. Some important points are there here. So whenever we are iron, we are extracting from the blast furnace, the produced iron is called pig iron. So pig iron is the impurest iron, which contains nearly 4% carbon and also some silicon, phosphorus, manganese, etc. are there. If this on purifying, we get cast iron. Cast iron containing 3% carbon. On further purifying, we get wrought iron. So wrought iron is called purest iron. It contains nearly 0.1 to 1.5% carbon. So very low percentage of carbon. So pig iron is the impurest iron, which contains 4% carbon. So why it contains carbon means iron ore we have purified. Iron ore we are reduced by using carbon or carbon dioxide in smelting process. So there must be some amount of carbon will be present. So 4% carbon we get in pig iron. After on purifying, 3% carbon will be present in cast iron. After that further purifying, we get wrought iron. Wrought iron, WROUGH. Wrought iron is the purest iron, mostly 0.1 to 1.5% carbon will be there. These are the types of iron present. So also some other definitions in the starting I explained. Gang flux and slag. So definition I already told, gang is an infusible impurity. Flux is the additional material to add it to remove that impurity. And flux and gang converted to slag, which is a fusible. For example, in the extraction of copper, some iron oxide present as an impurity. So gang is the iron oxide. So to remove this iron oxide, we add some additional material, SiO2. So this SiO2 is called flux. So here, this is the gang. And this is the flux. So it is in the extraction of copper and lead. In the extraction of copper, some impurities will be iron oxide. So it can be removed by using SiO2. So both can be converted to FeSiO3. So this is called slag. So gangue is infusible. It cannot remove easily. So it is heated with flux, converted to slag. Slag will be fusible. That means it can be easily removed. So same like in the extraction of iron. In the extraction of iron, calcium oxide present as impurity. In the extraction of copper, iron oxide is impurity. In the extraction of iron, calcium oxide present as impurity. To remove this, we add SiO2 converted to CaSiO3. So this is the slag. This is the gang. And this is the flux. So gangue is infusible. To remove the gangue, we add flux. The fluxes can be acidic also there, basic is also there. Since iron oxide, calcium oxides are basic, we add acidic flux. If impurities are basic, we add acidic. If impurities are acidic, we add basic fluxes. So gangue and flux converted to slag. Slag can be easily removed. So gangue cannot be easily removed, but slag can be easily removed. So these are the important equation in the extraction of copper. This is in the extraction of iron. So finally, let's see the structure. So this graph is called Ellingham diagram. So with the help of Ellingham diagram, we can identify so which metal is suitable for the reduction of a given work. So for a particular work, so which metal is suitable reducing agent, that we can identify by using Ellingham diagram. So this Ellingham diagram is based on Gibbs energy values with temperature. So Gibbs energy, temperature versus values are given. Temperature is from 0 to 2000 Celsius is given. The Gibbs energy from 0 to minus 100 kilojoule per mole is given. So we all know that whenever Gibbs energy is negative, the reaction is called spontaneous. Is it or not? So Gibbs energy, what is the use of Gibbs energy? It expands spontaneity or feasibility of a process. So that means whenever the Gibbs energy value is highly negative, then that process is easily feasible. So that's why how to work this diagram is, so whenever two graphs, for example, so this is the aluminium curve, whereas this is a magnesium curve. So both these curves will be coincide at a particular point. So at that particular point, so we can observe the temperature. So below this temperature, remember this, so wherever particles are coincide, wherever pulses are coincide, at that particular temperature, below that temperature, here suppose temperature is between 1200 and 600, so take us that is a 1300. So below this 1300, the lower metal can reduce upper metal. So that is the most important. Below the temperature, lower metal can reduce upper metal. That means between aluminium and magnesium, so magnesium is a strong reducing agent. Why? So magnesium is below, that means its Gibbs energy is very highly negative. So that means magnesium easily converted to magnesium oxide and compare with aluminium converted to aluminium oxide. Here also aluminium combining with oxygen, magnesium combining with oxygen. But magnesium Gibbs energy is very negative when compared with aluminium. So that's why magnesium reactivity to oxygen is more when compared with aluminium. So that's why magnesium is a better reducing agent when compared with aluminium below this temperature. That is, temperature is also most important. Why we are taking below this temperature? When temperature is low, then the process is profitable. So high temperature maintaining is very difficult. It is a costly process. That's why whatever the points are coincide, remember this, wherever points are coincide, so we have to take below temperature. So below that temperature, lower metal can reduce upper metals. That is the most important. So actually diagram they will give in the exam, they will ask which metal can reduce which metal at which temperature. So at this temperature, magnesium can reduce. Below this temperature, magnesium can reduce aluminium. See, similarly zinc and suppose copper, these are joining here. So below this temperature, zinc is a better reducing agent than the carbon. This is a carbon combining with oxygen. Zinc is combining with oxygen, but zinc is better reducing agent since zinc have negative Gibbs energy when compared with copper. So zinc is a better reducing agent. So like that, which is a better reducing agent, we can easily identify with the help of Ellingham diagram. So this diagram is based on values of Gibbs energy and temperature. So where all the points are coinciding? Below the temperature, lower metal can reduce upper metal. So let's say now, lower metal, which metal is reducing, which metal is an important question. So lower metal can reduce upper metal. So watch the class and solve the assignment whatever I have given. So thank you very much.